All right, so very good afternoon to all of you, our cherished viewers of Hot Issues on TV3. So, on Tuesday, the 21st of February 2017, the President of the Republic of Ghana, Nana Addo-Dankwa Akufo-Addo, delivered the State of the Nation address. Now, that has generated a lot of controversy. The figures he churned out, the minority NDC say, are not the right figures. The president says, well, the country's debt to GDP ratio is 74%. The NDC says, you cannot tell us that is 74%. Where are you getting the figures from? Do we have the real figures, or you're dealing with provisional figures? And then the president talks about the growth rate of 3.6% being the worst in 23 years. Well, the NDC has a response also, and they say that cannot be the case. It can't be that. And so where is the president getting his figures from? This afternoon on Hot Issues, we want to find out a few things. One, what is the country's debt stock? Two, what is that to the GDP ratio? And also find out, so what did we use all these things for? As well as find out why the minority thinks that, you know, the State of the Nation address as presented by the President Nana Addo-Dankwa Akufo-Addo is not the true picture of what the state of the Ghanaian economy is. My name is Winston Amwa, and this is Hot Issues. When we return after this break, I'll introduce my guest, and then we begin the discussions. Stay with us. We are right back after this break. All right, so welcome back from that short break, and thanks for staying with us. My guest this afternoon is now the ranking member of the Finance Committee of Parliament. You can call him the spokesperson for finance in Parliament on the minority side. And he is the Member of Parliament for Ejumako Enyen Esiam and former Deputy Minister of Finance. My guest, Cassiel Ato Forson. Honourable?
Good afternoon, and thank you very much for joining us. It's great to see you.
Great to see you too.
Good. So, how are you coping? Life after, you know, the finance ministry, now that you've left as deputy minister and you're out of the ministry, how's it?
Thank you very much. Let me also say that it's an honor to be here, but I see myself even more honored to have the opportunity to serve at the Ministry of Finance for 4 good years under President John Dramani Mahama. I think life after the Ministry of Finance, once upon a time, waking up around 5 o'clock, getting to work between 6:30 before 7 o'clock, and all of a sudden your workload is very much reduced. I think that you see yourself having a lot of time, and the question is how to put your time to good use. Okay. to benefit the people of this country. We are still in government. Government is not only the executive. I'm a member of parliament. My duty is to provide an oversight on the finance side. Okay. On behalf of my party, for the people of this country. So we're doing that well, and for me, the main focus is for Ghana to succeed.
So at least, to make Ghana succeed. At least now that, I mean, for now, it's more like a blessing in disguise. You have some burden lifted off you. You can afford to sleep a little bit longer.
Not necessary. I'm a young man. I want to work well. I wish to contribute my quota towards building this country at my young age. And when I retire, I can say that I've also contributed my quota. So I still want to wake up at 5 o'clock.
Oh, really?
And I'm still waking up at 5 o'clock.
Well, you still might be waking up at 5 o'clock, yes, so then you might not go to the office at 6 o'clock.
Yes, but I get to Parliament pretty early.
Pretty early.
It helps me to go back and read things that probably you didn't give a good read at it. And look things far more detail, and also, I mean, put some thoughts down, possibly write your memoirs for the work you've done at the Ministry of Finance.
That's a great one. So let's get to the work you did at the Ministry of Finance. How much did the NDC borrow within the 8 years? Of course, you spent four years at the ministry, but how much did the NDC borrow within 8 years in Western government?
You see, oftentimes we make mistakes by saying that one government borrowed A or B. Looking at how much the debt stock is today, it would be a mistake to say that, for instance, MPP at the time they were leaving left A. Today it moved from A to C. And for that matter, the difference between A and C, in the middle, the B, is what the NDC actually borrowed. Mistake. mistake in the sense that don't give the value at the end.
What do you
because in between things happen, and for that matter, what you left behind or what you've borrowed may have changed in value.
What are those things that happen in between?
An example. Uh-huh. The MPP leave in office in 2008. They've been very, very vociferous about the fact that they left behind a debt of 9.5 billion. That debt truly includes external component, debt that they borrowed in US dollars, debt that will be serviced in US dollars. Debt that will be repaid in US dollars. At the time they were leaving, the end period exchange rate was 1.2141.
Okay.
Check from the Bank of Ghana website.
Yeah.
It's available. Therefore, merely looking at the exchange rate at the time and converting the dollar component of their debt to the cedi and conclude that it's 9.5, it's very misleading.
What is misleading? What is misleading about that? Yes.
For instance, if today the MPP, when NDC was in power between 2009 to 2014 and 16, let's say early 17, if we had not borrowed at all, what would have been the present value of the debt the MPP left behind?
Tell me.
You see, clearly, you have to consider inflation and the fact that the current value of the dollar, for instance, let me give you an example. They borrowed the Eurobond of $750 million without putting in place measures to repay the Eurobond. And it was bullet payment. Bullet. So you service the debt biannually. Every half year, you pay the interest on it. At the end of the year, you are expected at the end of the 10th year, you are expected to pay the entire $750 million bulk to the investors. At the time they borrowed, the cedi to the dollar was 1.2141. In quote, end period. But it may even go below that because
the 2007, 0.95.
Yes. Okay. So if it's 0.95, depends, I don't think it was exactly to 0.95 because it was around September, so you have to look at
the
time.
After the redenomination.
Yes.
Yes, so I mean, the city was around 0.95.
Okay,
yes.
So if you look at that, today the dollar to the city may not be 0.95. They are going to service this debt or repay this debt using today's exchange rate. So the present value of what they borrowed last time as against today, it's not that amount. That is my argument. And that is why it will be misleading for His Excellency the President to pick the $122 billion and conclude that because when they were leaving, the debt at the time they were leaving nominally was 9.5 billion and therefore NDC borrowed 92% out of that debt,
so,
and the rest belongs
so
to
the debt is
MPP.
122 billion.
Yes.
Cities.
Yes.
But you argue that if you were to do the dollar term,
yes,
you'd realize that the NPP might have borrowed more.
Yes. Excellent. Excellent.
But your party also, at the time Dr. Bamia said you had borrowed about $39 billion, argued based on the city term.
Yes.
And said you couldn't have borrowed so.
Yes.
You pick the city value and say, well, our total debt stock is this amount. So it could only have been that.
Yes.
$26 billion at the time. When he told you that.
When he told you that it was
39 billion, you disputed it.
Yes, that is why I started when you asked me a simple question that how much did NDC borrow? I said it would be a mistake to look at what we left, what we came to meet and where we left and conclude that the middle is what you borrowed. And that is the analysis Dr. Bawumia did. Today, Ghana's debt to GDP, Ghana's debt, if you express it in US dollars, is 28 billion. It is far away from the 39 billion Dr. Bawumia is talking about. You understand? And that is where my argument is.
Good. And that is
so
where
I'm telling
and that's where the NPP also comes in and says that now, I mean, that's a selectivity you're talking about.
Yes.
And it's the same thing you did, you also doing here. And I tell you what, Dr. Bawumia argues, that there were times you borrowed money. Mm-hmm. You borrowed $1 billion. Mm-hmm. At the time, the CD was $2 to $1.
Yes.
So if you were to convert it in CD time, CD terms at the time, you would have borrowed 2 billion Ghana cedis. Okay. Mm. And so if he goes for everything, he says it is 39 billion.
No.
If you look at it now, hold on a minute, if you look at it now, okay, for instance, let me give you the same thing. At the time the NPP was leaving office, it was probably around $10 billion. Right?
$10 billion. No.
Hold on. Per the calculations we are doing.
No, per the calculations we're doing here. When they were leaving office, the debt in US dollars about $7.8 billion.
About $7.8 billion. Yeah. Now, if it was $7.8 billion, if we were to pick the same figure now, how much would that be?
Okay. So if you take the $7.8 billion and today's debt stock, you will notice that the debt stock has moved from $7.8 billion to about $28 billion.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. You can strike the difference between the two and say that the NDC borrowed A.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Clearly, I will have no argument with you.
Okay.
But in the case of Dr. Bawumia, when he was looking clearly, at the time we borrowed the money, convert it, whether it's cedis, convert it in US dollars at the time and draw a conclusion, that's also selectivity. That is what I'm talking about. It has no place in debt management. It has no place in modern day economic management. Nobody uses that. We have a standard way of calculating public debt. Standard, accepted by the world. It's a world practice. IMF uses it, the World Bank uses it, and nobody does that kind of analysis. And that is why what we are saying is that clearly, that point the MPP is raising doesn't exist. In fact, by merely picking the CD equivalent of the time at the time when they were leaving and drawing a conclusion that that is what they left behind nominally, as against what we have left behind by drawing, by saying that, hey, MPP, we borrowed only 8% of today's debt stock and NDC added 92%. We cannot accept
that. But unfortunately, it's the same thing that the NDC does when it comes to, you know, the debt stock. Because
I have not done that.
Well, you've not, but,
yes, but that is exactly what I'm telling you.
But I've heard the NDC do, even the president has done that before. Because if you look at, and I point the fact again, that Dr. Bawumia goes to pick all the debt agreements, the loan agreements, and does the calculation.
Mm-hmm.
And you realize that at the time that they were being borrowed, some of them, the CD was $2 to $1.
Mm-hmm.
If you look at it right now, like we've just told you, for instance, if you were to look at the debts now, okay, so the NPP tells you, I'm just using the NPP's example.
Yes.
They tell you, okay, so we've borrowed 9.5 billion Ghana cedis.
Yes.
The 9.5 billion Ghana cedis that the NPP is talking about now, okay, they've gone for the CD value.
Mm-hmm.
If they go for the dollar value, which is about 7 point something billion at that time, it was what? 9.5 billion. If we bring it now, it becomes what? About 28 billion.
Okay, let me take you
and,
through.
And that's the reason why he also at the time, I'm just drawing a point.
Yeah.
He at the time accused you of being selective, and you're accusing them now of being selective. It's as though when that you know, tables shift, then the politician changes how he sees things.
No, you see, where I'm coming from, it's not the fact, it's not me being selective or asking them to be selective. I'm being honest. I'm telling you the world practice, how we calculate debt, how multilateral institutions and bilateral institutions calculate public debt. It is there for everybody to check. Clearly, if I go for a loan today, you would think that probably I've gone to Parliament, whether a commercial loan, a bilateral or multilateral loan, I've gone to Parliament to get approval. You would think that probably I've said I'm going to borrow $250 million and you are giving it today's value. You make a mistake. Because that loan probably will have to use 2-3 years to draw down. 2-3 years to draw down. In some cases, even those ones that you have actually borrowed, you won't draw down everything before the loan, before you finish the project. So you have to agree with whoever you borrowed from and say that, hey, the difference, you are not taking it anymore.
Mm.
Or in some cases, look at the CDB facility. We went to Parliament, all right. We had an agreement with the CDB to have up to $3 billion. As we speak, we've not drawn down $3 billion. We've drawn down just above $1 billion. So by merely picking $3 billion because it's gone to Parliament, give it a value, add it to the debt stock, and say that, conclude that we have $39 billion, we borrowed $39 billion, it's very misleading.
Good.
So very misleading.
If I were to take the CD value and say 9.5 billion, 122 billion now, would I be right if I say the NDC is borrowed about 92% of the debt?
you will be misleading your viewers.
How would that amount to misleading?
You'll be misleading your viewers in simple terms. Remember that when MPP left office, that $9.5 billion had a foreign component. That foreign
component had a local component also.
And had a local component. Even the local component, you have to deflate it using inflation and deflate it and give it to the
its value would have gone down by now.
Yes, not only going down, depending on the situation. So what I'm saying is that you have to look at it. You have to look at it and then deflate it and give it today's value.
Okay.
By so giving it today's value, we've done the analysis. Okay, what so we have said.
Help me understand finally on this bit. Yes. Do you know how much the NDC borrowed within that 8 years?
By way of value,
we borrowed this much in dollars, that much in cedis. Yes. Do you know the figure?
What we have said is that given the MPP's time when they were leaving office, the debt they left behind of $9.5 billion, look at the cedis component, look at dollar component. Let's assume that we are using exchange rate, simple exchange rate instead of inflation to give it a value. We deflated it using the dollar. We arrived at 7.8. Exchange rate of 1.2141. As of December, when we're leaving office, the exchange rate was 4.181. Give the 7.8 a value. You realize that the debt that they left behind in today's value has come to about 36 billion. That 36, when you express it as a percentage of what we've left behind of 122 billion, you will notice clearly, that it's not correct that we borrowed 92% as the president put it. Indeed, the MPP left behind 26% of today's debt stock. But let me also tell you, it is also misleading to conclude that the MPP only left the 9.5 and they only borrowed 9.5 billion. They may have left 9.5, but they may not borrow 9.5.
How much did they borrow?
But let me tell you something. You remember, under the MPP, they were lucky to have the HIPIC reliefs, MDRI reliefs coming in, multi-donor relief initiative from the World Bank and HIPIC from the IMF. The two put together, they had reliefs of almost $4 billion. Coming in, these reliefs will ideally would have gone to borrow, so that would have been a debt. So the reliefs came into the economy. Number two,
That it was okay. So when it's time for repayment, you use for social interventions.
But it's an expenditure.
So they make the point that it wasn't as if it's written.
So
that. It was a debt they had. But when it's time for you to go and pay, that means that you'd have used it.
I know they used some of them.
You met and used for free SH, free exercise books and free school uniforms.
Some of them to build public toilets. We know that.
And some you used to buy free exercise books.
Let me say something to you. That 4 billion is undeniable fact. It would have been an expenditure. And they had no choice at the time than to go and borrow. So they had space. It's a fiscal space. You borrow because you don't have fiscal space. If the space is not there, you run a budget deficit, you have no choice than to go and borrow.
Okay.
That is what you have to understand, clearly.
Well, we need to go for a short break. When we return after this break, we'll find out more about, the fiscal space. There's been lots of issues concerning how much, goes into wages, how much goes into, government transfers, and how much goes into the payment of loans, and whether or not we have fiscal space and how sustainable that is. Stay with us. My guest this afternoon, Hot Issues, is Honorable Cassiel Ato Forson, who was Deputy Finance Minister during the second term of the NDC. That's, NDC 4, if we could put it that way. Stay with us. We'll be right back after this break. All right, so welcome back from that short break and thanks for staying with us. This is Hot Issues and my guest this afternoon, former Deputy Minister of Finance, Cassiel Ato Forson, and also who is the Member of Parliament for Ejumako Inyan Esiam constituency in the Central Region. But I just listened to what the President Nanado Danko Akufo-Addo said, in a State of the Nation address, and then would come back in studio and continue with the discussions. We get some more reactions from Honorable Cassiel Ato Forson.
The economy of our country is in a bad way. You would recall that notwithstanding the fact that the previous government had more than 10 times the financial resources than any other government since independence. In the run-up to the 2012 presidential and parliamentary elections, resulted in a quagmire that necessitated the urgent intervention of the International Monetary Fund, IMF, in 2014. The previous government promised Ghanaians that the reckless public expenditure that characterized the 2012 election year would not be repeated. Mr. Speaker, the promises to the Ghanaian people were, however, not kept. All the targets under the IMF program as of December 2016 have been missed. Fiscal indiscipline once again reared its head in the 2016 election year. Total projected expenditure for 2016 was 443.9 billion CDs, that is 26% of GDP, but actual expenditure amounted to 50.3 billion Ghana CDs, 30.2% of GDP. It appears from what we are finding out that some 7 billion CDs of arrears and outstanding payments circumvented the very public financial management system that was put in place to prevent such occurrence. Mr. Speaker, the combination of higher expenditures and lower revenues than projected resulted in a significant increase in the budget deficit for 2016. As compared to a target of 5.3% under the IMF program, the fiscal deficit for 2016 was 9% of GDP on a cash basis and 10.2% of GDP on a commitment basis. That is, on the basis of expenditures undertaken but not yet paid for. It should be recalled that at the time Ghana entered into the IMF program to restore fiscal discipline, the fiscal deficit was 10.2% of GDP. It is very clear, therefore, that the objectives set out in the program have not been achieved. Mr. Speaker, the increasing fiscal deficits were financed by increased borrowing. As at the beginning of 2009, Ghana's total debt stock was 9.5 billion CDs. By the end of 2016, the debt stock has ballooned to 122 billion CDs. Ghana's debt stock now stands at 74% of GDP after all the previous denials to the contrary. Mr. Speaker, more debt was accumulated by the previous government in the last 8 years than all other governments put together since independence. In fact, 92% of Ghana's total debt stock was incurred in the last 8 years under the previous government. The interest costs on this debt have also increased and will amount to an estimated 14.1 billion CDs in 2017. Today, as a result of policy choices, we find ourselves in a situation where Ghana's total revenue is consumed by three main budgetary lines: wages and salaries, interest payments and amortization, and statutory payments. These three items alone account for 99.6% of government revenue.
Okay, so that's the President Nana Addo-Dankwa Akufo-Addo talking about, you know, the country's total revenues that we generated, as well as expenditure, what we budgeted for, and the actual expenditure. I'll just take your reaction briefly on, you know, some of these figures where he talks about, you know, the growth rate and everything. Then we continue. Your reactions, basically.
Thank you. What he talked about, particularly relating to the fact that the expenditure moved from 43 billion to 50 billion. We have served notice in Parliament that we are waiting for the budget statement to come and confirm these numbers. Because we
Why are you waiting for the budget statement?
Because we know for sure that we did not exceed our appropriations. We know for sure at the time we were leaving the office, expenditure, and he used the word total expenditure, and he said it's 9%. I don't know the nominal GDP is actually getting the 9% from. If it's 9%, then my calculation does not give me, based on the nominal GDP that I know. So let us wait for the budget statement to come. It's only Tuesday, Thursday.
What is your calculation?
Look, so I want my
viewers to understand.
Yes.
What is your calculation?
You see, what we know, mm-hmm. what we've seen clearly, is that the MPP is trying to establish a 7 billion expenditure. They cannot use the word expenditure for the 7 billion that they're making reference to. That 7 billion they're making reference to is actually commitment. Expenditure is what you have paid for. Commitment is something that the government in various MDAs have committed in contracts. That is awaiting processes of payment. So it has various stages of processes. You cannot term that as expenditure. And that is why we've served notice to in Parliament that we await the budget statement. Let the budget statement confirm that indeed is 50 billion. But I'm not convinced that indeed the NDC administration spent, and use the word expenditure, 50 billion.
What are you convinced the NDC administration spent?
We have said mm-hmm. that we stayed within our appropriations. The budget, what was approved by Parliament, was 43 billion, and we were within the 43 billion.
You didn't go outside the 43 billion?
Not at all. We were within the 43 billion. We'll wait for the budget statement. I don't want us to go deep into this. Let's wait for the budget statement. It's another topic from Thursday, and maybe we can have a discussion on that on Thursday.
Hmm. He also talks about the growth rate.
Yes, he talked of growth. 3.6%. He talked of growth.
Worst in 23 years.
Yes, he talked of growth. But let me first of all correct that. Mm-hmm. 3.6 is provisional. Mm. It cannot. The president cannot be emphatic.
It's estimated.
Yes, no, he never said that.
Well, that's what I
No. Can you play it back?
In reading, hold on.
Please. I have a copy of the State of the Nation.
Yes, you check it. Estimated.
Yes. No, please.
Or we could just.
Please,
could just
check it. You can check it. Yes, you can check it. He never used the word estimated. He said, no, please. Don't read for the president. Don't speak for the president. I don't know you to be a spokesperson of the president.
I am not, but that's what I read.
So, what I'm telling you is that I've also read. Yesterday, I took a debate on it. I presented his own State of the Nation. Mm-hmm. I referred to the paragraph, what he said. So you cannot read something different, and I have a copy of what was delivered before Parliament, and tell me what the president said is different from. The president was emphatic of 3.6%. What we are saying is that he should have said estimated or provisional, because it can only be an assumption. Until Ghana Statistical Service comes out, there's no way you can place your hand on a finger and say that, your finger on something and say that, hey, this has been done. This is 3.6. It's not 3.6. Let's await Ghana Statistical Service. Mm. And until Ghana Statistical Service comes out and say that the growth was 3.6, yes, fine. But even if it's 3.6, even if it's 3.6, let us look at the actors of growth. What goes into growth and why probably we've gotten to where we are? Indeed, we were open. We came out to say that one of the major drivers of growth, oil, the oil production. We are aware that the FPSO suffered some setback. The terrain bearing of the FPSO developed some fault, and therefore it affected the revenue and affected the output, total output. So it's not only affecting revenue, it's affecting output. So you notice that what we projected in terms of revenue, and it talks about the fact that we couldn't achieve revenue. Yes, we couldn't achieve revenue. Various reasons. One is on account of oil not actually performing because the FPSO developed fault. This is what we are saying. In terms of growth, we are seeing that growth slowed down because in terms of production from oil sector, it wasn't performing. You see the oil sector growth actually declining on the back of that because we couldn't get the production that we have estimated to have. These are various reasons. They are exogenous. They are external. It is outside the control of me and you. Mm. I can go and fix the FPSO. It takes time. It takes the engineers to work on it. And I'm telling you, that if care is not taken this year, FPSO at Tamils will be going back. Will be going back for them to fix. And it's going to affect
the oil sector. Back for them to fix.
Yes, what's because the turret bearing has developed a major fault. They had to manage it to take us through the year. And from what I'm hearing, they may send it back for fixing if they can't fix it here. And it may take off. It may be off for a couple of months, which can affect not only revenue, can also affect GDP growth. So we should put things in perspective. And the last time I checked, the GDP growth for 1994 was 3.3%. So even the calculation is wrong. It can be 23 years.
1994.
The GDP growth was 3.3%. So 3.6% is way above 3.3%. So from 1994 to 2016, certainly it's not 23 years.
I mean, do I get the impression that's a justification? Of
no,
what
no.
We have?
I'm telling you that you see a lot of inaccuracies, and I'm saying that in future, those preparing the president's speech should check. He's the president of the republic. When he speaks volume. He's our president, my president, your president. When he speaks, it should be final. I shouldn't have what it takes to come and tear the president's speeches about. You should make sure your I is dotted, your T is crossed. It's not 23 years.
But are you happy about the growth rate we achieved, the provisional growth rate we achieved last year?
Last year again. Mm-hmm. You remember the IMF estimated 3.5. Okay, and the same MPP came out as one of the worst, but we ended up with 4%. Okay, so it's like that. So IMF can say one thing, Fitch can say something, people can come out with estimation, Ministry of Finance can estimate something. But until Ghana's Task Service comes out to declare exactly how we ended the year, but we're optimistic, looking at how we fared in the course of the year, that probably we will be exceeding the 3.6.
But are you proud of that provisional 3.6?
Let me say something. Mm-hmm. It's not about me being proud. It's about what accounted for that growth. What accounted for that growth? I've seen MPP looking at trends and saying that, hey, they are better off. But you see, we had a mandate of 8 years. They had a mandate of 8 years. We looked at who grew the economy from where to where. Mm. Okay, they grew their economy an average of 5.6%. Even if I agree and add the 3.6 as provisional, that since Ghana's Task Service is yet to come out, let's stick with the president 3.6 or the Ministry of Finance 3.6 estimation. If you strike an average, it's 6.8. So when it comes to who grew the economy, you can always give credit to
them. Is it not a shame and worrying that in 2011,
yes,
we grew at 14.4%?
Yes,
and recently I've seen figures of 15%.
Yes.
Then it comes to 2012, it's around 9%. And then from 2013, we begin to go down up until this time.
It's the setbacks.
When you had been in office.
You see, it's the setbacks the country face. You can't always, there are high and lows of a country. Mm-hmm. Country goes through high and lows. There are times that things are good. I mean, MPP at one upon a time grew to about 9%. Mm-hmm. The growth at MPP time was about 9% in 2008. But it dropped the following year to 4%. 4%, 5% at 4. Because in 2008, the investment in CAN 2008 was the one that pushed the growth at the time. Major investment.
Hold on 1 minute. I mean, we definitely would come back to this particular question, the bit about what really went wrong. We need to go for a short break. When we return after this break, I'll get Honorable Cassiel Ato Forson to address this particular issue, as well as other issues concerning the State of the Nation address on Hot Issues with me, Winston Amwa. Stay with us. We'll be right back. All right, so welcome back from that short break, and thanks for staying with us. I still have here with me Honorable Cassiel Ato Forson, former Deputy Minister of Finance and Member of Parliament for Ejumahu Enyan Isiam constituency in the Central Region, and the Minority Spokesperson on Finance. So yes, you were explaining 14.4%, some have said 15%, it gets to 9%, and then we move, I mean, in 4 years, we're at 3.6%. Clearly, we haven't done well.
You see, you can just sit at one place at your corner and say that we haven't done well.
But of course, we haven't. The figures say we haven't done well.
No, you can just look at it and conclude. But let me let you know that there are certain factors that drives growth. Mm-hmm. You see, some of them are external shocks. Some of them are internal shocks. A major shock that we've seen in recent years was the energy crisis. Okay? The NDC, we've been very out to explain the major causes of the energy crisis.
Was that not self-inflicted on ourselves?
Self-inflicted, it depends on the investment you put in. Mm. You ask yourself, how much did MPP put in the form of investment during the 8-year rule of MPP? For that matter, where we are, you ask yourself, how much investment has the NDC put in place in the way of energy generation? And who is at fault? We are not here to apportion blames. But let me tell you that it's not fault of the NDC, because we had a crisis, we had to deal with it, and we dealt with it. That energy crisis more or less caused a major growth setback. The services sector started suffering, and it drew back some of the gains. So it is not new. It is not new that we are seeing hot mess. But as I said, countries go through major setbacks. There are high times and low times, even in lives. The world is not smooth. It happens. But don't judge me during my low time alone. Judge me in my high times and draw an average over the 8 years, what I managed to do.
Well, except that in your case, you're Deputy Finance Minister.
Yes.
And from 2013
yes.
To 2017. Yes. And so if I were to judge your performance, I probably would look at from that period till now.
Oh, yes, yes.
And I would be wrong if I were to do so.
Nothing stops you from doing that. But you can't also judge me wrong by saying that I failed to put the investment in place in the oil sector, in the energy sector, particularly to deal with the doomsday situation we experienced. You can't fault me.
Who
you have
you
to fault the MPP. You ask yourself, what sort of investment do they put in place? Successive government, fault them. Mm. Don't only look at the current situation, but look at what actually caused the current situation and fault them.
But they would argue they put, yes, of course, from 2007, they put investments in place, some of which you came to complete as a government.
But the question is, one investment, is that good enough?
And so in that situation,
is that good enough?
In that situation, for instance, if they put investments in place, you came to commission some of them mm-hmm. during the reign of Professor Atta Mills.
Yes.
And then moving forward in his last term, mm. in his last year, well, after his demise, we have a challenge mm-hmm. of, you know, power crisis. Mm-hmm. Who do we blame?
So I'm asking you. Mm-hmm. Whether the investment they put in place is enough or
you
not enough. I don't think it's enough.
It's you don't
woefully
think it's
inadequate. Okay, well. But let me also say something. We were here when we noticed that the West Africa gas pipeline that was put in place, the gas is not flowing. And for that matter, some of the thermal plants were also not coming on stream. Mm. Asogre in particular. So if it's not coming on stream, and I didn't break it. It's not President John Dramani Mahama's administration that used the ship to break
it. But
you
had to fix it.
It's not up to us, West Africa Gas Pipeline.
Yes, but
we're a shareholder, so it's been fixed.
Yes, so.
And it's fixed. But the question is that force majeure, something has happened.
Exactly, but for me.
And when it happens, it's a shock.
Yes, but for me as a citizen, because I have voted for a certain party to govern, I would look at that party and say, you know what? You're supposed to fix it. Like, you know, Akufo-Addo said in 2009, and he's been told the same thing today, fix them, do not complain, do not tell me why things cannot be done, tell me how you have fixed them. But we need to move on to another issue, one, you know, controversial issue. They ask, where are the projects? What did we use the loans for?
You live in Accra, don't you?
Yes, I live in Accra.
You've been around in the country. Hmm. The loans are the investment in your future.
Share some of them with me.
I give you an example. Where are we? Kanda, huh? Hmm. Just go back there, look at Circle. You see the interchange there. Mm-hmm. That is part of your loan. You go through the city of Accra, you see asphalt, major places. That is part of it. Go to Flowerpot. You've been to Spinters Road recently. Mm-hmm. There's a road connecting Spinters Road all the way through Bema Camp to East Traffic. It's investment in your life, it's part of your loan. Mm. You've seen Ghana Gas. You know what it's doing today? Ghana Gas today is helping me and you to get power. That is a reality. It's part of your loan. You've gone to Commander Sugar Factory. It's investment there. It's your loan. I can count them, go on and on and on and on. But let me say, let me say that as long as you prepare a national budget and you throw out a primary deficit, you throw out a deficit, it means you are actually going to borrow to fund your debt, your expenditure. The difference, the deficit. Simple.
Can GDP do without borrowing?
I don't think so. They have no choice.
The president says it is not sustainable.
Oh, the president can say it's not sustainable. I agree with him. Borrowing is not a sustainable way of running a country. But let me say that based on the promises that he has actually given to Ghanaians, I think that what he himself called unsustainable, he cannot sustain it.
Cassiel Ato Forson,
thank you
very much for joining
us.
All right, so that's all from us this afternoon, Hot Issues on TV3. Thank you so much for joining us. And of course, thank you also, Honorable Cassiel Ato Forson, former Deputy Minister of Finance and Member of Parliament for Ejimakwe Nyanisiam constituency and the Central Region and Minority Spokesperson on Finance. My name is Winston Amwa. Do have a lovely weekend. And don't forget to join me on Monday on Sunrise on 3FM 92.7 from 5:50 to 10 a.m. I'll see you next week.